Good afternoon, Mr. President.
How are you?
Nice of you to receive us, but the status is that we have to deliver.
I know. The law only called for September 29th, and I'm not used to anybody in government doing things early.
It's Constitution Day today, so we thought we'd do that.
I know. It's also another day. It's the, I know, the 198th anniversary of the signing of the Constitution, but it's also the 39th anniversary of your 39th birthday.
Exactly.
This is not really a
gift. Nice to see you.
It's not really a gift. It's just a little souvenir.
Souvenir.
To the occasion here.
No. Well, you know, Dr. Town, the staff director, and Ron Lamb, of course, I don't need to introduce. We'll have many copies of these very shortly over for distribution within your own staff, and I think we'll be sending copies to, if you don't object, to all the members of the cabinet and the agency heads, and of course, to the speaker and to the vice president, and all right. Others.
Listen, I think they want us to come in and sit down here and get a look.
We decided that we might as well use the day and the occasion.
If you hold it up, Mr. President, they can see the entire Constitution on the back of the report.
Those are hard to read, though.
That's almost as small as the writing in the letter I got from some women in one of the labor camps in the Soviet Union. Go to the
and it has to be small to get out.
Thank you.
Yes, you know, I think, of course, this is wonderful, and I think the 200th that's coming up is. I've made it a point to read a number of constitutions I've been able to, including the Soviet Constitution. I was surprised to find that there's some terms in there of things that they're guaranteeing to their people the same as in ours.
Exactly.
Except that they have never implemented them or let them have those freedoms.
In 77, I was over in the Soviet Union on a personal invitation which Brezhnev had attended and given to me when I was here at a White House dinner for him. And when we had our session in his office in the Kremlin, I gave him a very special copy of our Constitution. He said, oh, we have one now, a new one, just like yours, about that thick. And I didn't cross-examine. I thought I was a guest, and I'd better be a little polite. But then I suggested to him that he could have saved himself a lot of work to just take ours and copy it. Then I presented him with a facsimile of the inkwell that was used to sign the Constitution. I don't know if it registered with him, but at any rate, we had a little fun over it.
Well, you know, I can't claim that I've read all the constitutions in the world, but I read enough that I believe, reasonably.
The farmer.
Hello, Mr. President.
Let's go back to North Carolina.
Yeah.
Right. Mr. President,
see you.
Well, hey, Jack.
I think we're going to have to sit for a minute since
I was just a chair. I was around.
That's great.
How y'all doing, Jack?
Pretty good. Very good.
Well, I'll tell you, the president got a thunderous ovation. NC State University 2 weeks ago Thursday. Temperature changed a little bit too, hadn't it?
Yes, it's a little warm there.
No air conditioning, right?
Right. But it was, I'm still, after all my years in the Vietnam days of the government, I'm still trying to get used to students cheering. They burned me in effigy then. And these kids were judging me.
Cheerleaders. I had told them outside, you know, I did that. I said, what does that mean? And I told them, that's deaf language for I love you. They said, great. So,
I thought they were giving them fingers.
right down in front. I gave them the sign. Oh, they got delighted with that.
Is that the 17th?
18th September 1985. This is a meeting with the president and the speech writers in the Oval Office, right on camera, right on recorder.
Can you see one of those?
No. I'll beat the horn.
I guess we ought to call Ray and Bud. Israel. but they were most enthusiastic. It was a very rewarding experience there.
So if you got your distance of Boston, so you're going to have a few of them.
Probably came down from Doc.
Mr. President, this is just a get-together with the speechwriters, and we thought it would be advantageous for them and for you. Maybe there would be sort of an interchange here, and you could speak your mind on what you want in some of these speeches in terms of taxes and petroleum spending and trade, east-west relations, and foreign policy generally, whatever you just tell them what you want to say in those speeches.
Well, first of all, I'm not dissatisfied. I thank you all. But I tell you, I've always, the years past out there in the mashed potato circuit, I've always believed that specificity is the soul of credibility. By that, I mean where possible, where something of fact and figure can be used instead of eloquent appeals in rhetoric. And I've subjected you to this one before, but I remembered years ago when I was talking about big government, and this was long before I was any part of government or thought I ever would be. But I remember an example once. And the whole farm program. And believe me, back there, it was just as controversial as it is now, and just as harmful. Now, you could have gone for a whole page talking about freeing the farmers and what should be done and everything. But I got one figure example that did it all. And that was that, if I remember correctly, the numbers that I had found, that was that there were 6 farm programs, federal programs, to encourage poultry raisers to increase egg production. There was a 7th government program to finance the government purchase of surplus eggs. Well, I think that tells it all. I found another one like it once at a country club that had some land it owned just alongside a couple of its fairways, and it wasn't using it, leased it to a farmer who raised corn on it. And then the country club got to the place where they decided to use that land and extend the fairways and make 2 holes longer and all of that. They got a check from the government for taking corn land out of production.
Well, this is great, yeah.
Hi, Mr. President. How are you?
Good to see you.
Good to see you.
Thank you.
What's going on, Chairman? How are you doing?
You can offer my wife a recommendation. My wife had gone into the old antique business, and the bank was giving her a problem. They take a check, and they went, "I'll call up Mr. Baker. Will that be enough?" First, they had to get which Mr. Baker. And she said, "I think maybe I could get a letter from the president. It might take a little longer. Would that be satisfactory?" Well, that's the things they gave you.
Listen, I want to hear from you, but this thing, you know how I feel about the tax reform, and I've just come from hearing tens of thousands of people in a mass outdoor rally. Cheering wildly every time I mentioned it in every facet of it. And I know what you're doing, and I appreciate very much the cooperation. What I'm concerned about very much is, and you know, the leadership has talked about maybe having to go home before that we can do this. Well, then that means next year. But I think there's something we have to consider politically. Danny Rastankowski is working as hard as he can to get this thing out. The worst thing in the world that could happen to us for next year is to have the Democratic-dominated House pass a tax reform bill and have the Republican-dominated Senate go home on recess, leaving it there till next year, and how they would use that against us.
Let me tell you where we are, because I think we can do it. I have said in the past, get it to me by October 15th, we can make it this year. Really, I can do it even if I don't get it till the 1st of November. That the Congress stays in. I mean, if Tip O'Neill and Bob decide to go home at Thanksgiving and they adjourn, then I can't make it, but presumably they would keep us in for the tax bill. Or at a minimum, let the people go home and leave the committees there. Let the committees work on it and go to conference, and when we're, I must have to call the Senate back. We can get it, but if they don't go. What I'm worried about, more importantly, is trade. Because if I were the Democrats, what I would do is put a very...
The current approach towards being per diem, and then also outline the legislation that we're proposing for your approval. First of all, as far as the current system is concerned, we really have today a two-tier system. For some 400 high-cost cities, we're reimbursing the federal traveler for its actual cost for meals and lodging up to a ceiling of $75 per day. It's a very expensive, very paper-intensive program overall. For the smaller cities, we're reimbursing the federal traveler for his actual cost for lodging and providing a flat rate, $23 a day for meals, up to a ceiling, an overall ceiling in those cities of $50 per day. Any change that we make in the ceilings requires a congressional approval. Just to put it in perspective, the total travel cost, food and lodging for the civilian follows through with similar legislation. I think there are really three major issues that we need to deal with and three problems that we're having overall. One is the administrative costs of the system is too high. We're spending $160 million a year administering food, lodging, and the whole per diem system. That's roughly 10% of the budget for food and lodging. The problem we have is very paper.
Mr. President, I would like to have you, and this is going to be a very thoughtful reading type, study type pose. I know I've never seen you with your hand to your face or anything like that. Do you cross your legs and you do anything like that here and there? When you really come and study, I'm not trying to say.
I'm usually right.
Just like
you're
at
this, Or I can turn.
But you can turn this way. Cross. That's it.
All right.
it's not natural, I don't know if it's good, it doesn't feel right. But if you do a thoughtful, if you really mean it, that's okay, well, that's okay. Towards the window, just put your body in that position, but look towards the window, as if you're just in a thoughtful type of. That's right. Just look right off like that, Mr. President. That's fine. Hopefully. Towards the window. Be looking in that direction. If you just have a, if you just be flipping as if you were looking for, there you are. See him that often.
Interesting idea.
I got to get that.